Welcome to the Three Knockdown Rule. Starring Mario Lopez and Steve Kim. Presented by Hustler Casino and UFC Fight Pass.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Three Knockdown Rule on UFC Fight Pass is in effect. I'm Steve Kim, joined by Mario Lopez. And Mario, no monikers today. We got to get right into it. We have a very special guest joining us in studio.
Oh, someone that I've had the pleasure of knowing for a long time now. A real boxing aficionado, and keeps himself in the gym and is looking great. Mr. Frank Stallone is in the building.
All right, you guys.
Hey.
I'm a big fan of your show.
So you're the one. But anyway, look, speaking of the show, this podcast is sponsored by Hustler Casino, located in Gardena, California, just 20 minutes from downtown L.A. Check out the latest promo, So Fine Sundays, where they're giving away tons of cash. Beat the stadium traffic and play your favorite games at Hustler Casino. For more info, go to HustlerCasino.com.
Also, big shout out to our guys here at Scout Micro LA. They offer a unique and innovative hair solution for men. They specialize in something called SMP, which is essentially state-of-the-art restoration service that replicates the exact shape and follicle of your hair by tattooing tiny particles of pigment into the scalp, giving the illusion of hair. It's a big thing, and it's a real thing. You can see results as little as one treatment. They can restore hairlines, give the appearance of thicker, more dense hair, and especially if you're rocking a close-cropped hairstyle, concealed any sort of issue you may have, camouflage burn, skin condition. They use the highest quality. So if you're going bald, looking for a new look, hit up our friends at Scalp Micro. Mention this ad for a free consult.
If you're getting thin, he'll help fill you in.
Well, Mario, you won't have that problem.
Hey,
like Ronald Reagan hairline.
We'll see. You're looking good, Frank. I want to jump right in because you were prominently featured in the new Netflix documentary, Sly, of course, pertaining to your brother, Sylvester Stallone. And I learned a lot when I thought I knew a lot about both of you gentlemen. Of course, you were born in Hell's Kitchen in New York. And then when your parents, correct me if I'm wrong, split. Yeah. You went with your father to Philly.
I went with my mother.
Your mother. You went with your mother. I keep saying that. You went with your mother to Philly, and then Sly went with his with your father.
Yes.
To
State of Maryland.
State of Maryland.
Yes.
Correct.
Mm-hmm.
And then at what point did you sort of reconvene? It didn't cover that.
Well, we reconvened. He stayed, so he's 4 years older than me. So this is like 1958, 57. So my mother left in 56 when I was 6 years old. I went to live with my aunt. Of course, they put me in Catholic school from public school. I failed the first grade. Shows you how bright I was. So anyway.
How do you fail the first grade?
That's tell me about it.
Prop 48 here.
Because we were like printing in Catholic school. They were, right, you know. And so then my parents got divorced. I stayed with my aunt. And then my parents went through the divorce. My brother stayed in Maryland. I went to Philadelphia. And then after a few years of my father, my brother moved to Philadelphia. Yeah.
Oh, so he did. What age did he come over to Philly with you?
He came over probably a few years later. Well, he did come. Matter of fact, he did come. He stayed with my father, but he did come to Philly in 1959. He went there, stayed for like 2 years. Then he went back to Maryland to live with my father, which was not the most pleasant thing. And then I stayed in Philadelphia, and then a few years later, after being thrown out of so many schools, and we went to the same military school, and then he came back to Philly, and then from Philly, you know, he went on to college and stuff like that.
Wow, so into Philly there. One thing that was fascinating is that your father, who was
rough guy,
a big folk boy. Yeah, he was a rough guy. He seemed
big hands.
Big hands. Yeah, well, both of you guys got paws.
Yeah,
so hands. He was a hairdresser.
He was a tough hairdresser. But yeah,
I was going to say, that's a masculine hairdresser.
You know, Mario, in those days, all World War II guys, you know, were on the GI Bill. How do you meet chicks? Become a hairdresser. So all these guys, like, had anchor tattoos. All right, you know, cutting women's hair.
Yeah.
It was, they were the hairstylists then, not like
hairstylists. And correct me if I'm wrong, but was your mother at one point like a psychic, or she did
astrology.
Yeah. See, I thought
she was eclectic.
Yeah, she was.
She was eclectic. She was a piece of work.
And how was the relationship with mom?
off and on. But it wasn't the. In other words, people ask me why I'm not married. I go watch the documentary. She was rough. She was married 5 times. My father 4 times.
Oh wow.
Yeah. And
so you got half brothers and half sisters out there?
Yeah, like 6.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
But you and
Sly are from the same
mom and dad.
Yeah.
Got it. So that's the only one. So
and I have a half brother and 2 half sisters. My other sister died, but so I had 3 half and my brother and I.
Wow.
And then my father married a woman with 4 kids, which was real bright. And then he had my sister, and then he married another woman and he had a kid. So my father would be 103. Oh. I have a brother 27.
Wow.
So my father had a kid with his wife. Well, she had the kid. He was like 77. Not the smartest thing in the world, but
seed stayed strong.
That's a lot to unpack right there. And you guys managed to stay pretty focused and driven and ambitious and not get in any kind of serious trouble.
No, I never got in trouble. I was petrified of getting. Believe me, I was a lousy student. I was just looking at my report cards from like D, D, E, a C. I'd be like ecstatic. Flunked music.
Yeah, well, that brings me to my next segue, because I got to say, I don't know if I've ever told you, but I'm a big fan of the Staying Alive soundtrack.
Thank you.
That was awesome. That was my buddy over there sitting in the corner. Yeah. Far From Over awesome song.
Thank
quintessential
you.
80s right there. Yeah. And really, I'm glad I got to showcase your talent. I know it reached number 10 on the Billboard Hot 100. Correct me if I'm wrong.
Some charts it was 7, some it was 1.
Love it.
I remember I was number 1 for a moment, and I was above Thriller, Synchronicity. Ooh.
Look at that.
And Billy Joel. And I said, man, all right. I mean, just to even be in the top 10 or top 5 then, I mean, look at the competition
that
year.
Great soundtrack.
Yeah.
It was a great soundtrack.
I mean, you had Flashdance, you had Thriller, you had Lionel Richie's album was huge, Billy Joel, and then you had The Police, Synchronicity.
All legends.
So it was pretty tough competition.
That is incredible. And it was Grammy nominated too, right?
I was nominated for a Grammy for Best Soundtrack.
Look, you know, that.
Golden Globe for Best Song.
That's right, Golden Globe.
Frank,
that's right.
There was a part of Sly where you guys touched upon it, that your brother's success was going to impact you and not necessarily always positively.
No, it was pretty negative. I mean, the thing is, my brother at one point used to help me move my equipment with my band. So he wasn't like, you know, the flavor of the month. So what happened is, when Rocky came out, I was out here when they were rehearsing it with Sonny Shields, Randy's father, and Gene LaBelle was acting as the referee when they were, And my album, we just signed with RCA. So my album almost came out the same time Rocky. Now, I don't care if you came out with Thriller, you couldn't have competed with Rocky when it came out. It was just too big.
Right.
10 Academy Award, just a perfect movie. So what happened, I think, coincidentally, people probably think I thought I just picked up the guitar the day Rocky came out.
Yeah, right. Exactly. They thought exactly.
But Sly, I got a song for you.
Yeah, I got a song for you.
Yeah.
So I've been in bands. I've been playing the club circuit, like dives and stuff, for 12, 13 years at that point.
Wow.
I started in 1965. I was playing Beatles songs when the Beatles were still together in bars.
Sure.
So, and what happened is it was just one of those things. And I got hit hard more because when he came, it's not like an actor went big. Rocky was iconic.
Yeah.
I mean, here's an
like unknown phenomenon. Yeah.
It was an unknown actor. The most known actor was Burgess Meredith, you know?
Yeah. Right.
As the Penguin. That's what they knew
him
from.
That's right. That's right. Batman. That's right.
So
he was so good in that.
He was the best.
He was so good.
Take you back. That's right. And so what happened is, I think coincidentally, I just all of a sudden went from Frank Stallone, rock and roll guy, great band. We won all the Battle of the Bands. All of a sudden, I went from that to Rocky's brother. Like, I just went for it's like almost like my whole 12 years was like evaporated. And I had to kind of claw back.
How was the dynamic with you and your brother during that time?
Fine. You know,
you always got along.
No, we fight a lot.
Sure, we're brothers. You're brothers.
We don't always get along. But the thing was, I remember we were sitting in a hotel. Remember, Rocky was a very cheap movie. It was $800,000 or something like that. Mm. And I remember looking at the dailies in the cheap hotel room in Philadelphia. I said, there's something that I can't put my finger on it. There's something special. I'm seeing right now Streetcar Named, I mean, you know, on the waterfront, yeah. all that Ilya
Kazan
stuff.
He talked about that, how he took a little bit of On the Waterfront, a little Mean Streets, and wanted to blend it all. Something else that I didn't know, because I thought I knew everything about Rocky, I didn't know that Ken Norton was originally cast to play Apollo Creed.
That's right.
Wow, I don't know if Ken Norton could act, but he certainly would have looked the part. But man, Carl Weathers ended was just so perfect.
And Burt Young was perfect.
Perfect.
No one could.
Rest in peace.
I mean, I would say that was probably one of the... Godfather was a perfectly cast movie. I think Rocky was a perfectly cast movie. Now, the one Sly wanted for Mickey was Lee J. Cobb.
Really?
So Lee J. Cobb, my favorite actor, Johnny Friendly from On the Waterfront.
Yeah.
Great actor, right? So he came in to read and he goes... This is a fantastic script and blah, blah. So John Avildsen says, okay, Lee, would you read for us? And Sly goes, excuse me? Read for this like cheap movie? And he goes, well, the last time I read was for Ilya Kazan on the Waterfront. So thank you. It's a great script. Have a good time. Sly wanted to kill John Avildsen.
Ooh, wow.
But Burgess did a great job.
No, Burgess was incredible.
He was made for that role.
Yeah, made for that role.
Frank, I have a question. What is the problem? You know, I'll be honest with you. Pushin' is a song that I listen to regularly. And in my head, as I'm working out doing cardio, I think of a house of ill repute with bubbles going on. Because that's the scene where he's training for Clubber Lang.
Yeah, yeah.
And I love that song. What is the process of actually getting a song on a soundtrack? How does that work?
Well... I'd done, as you mentioned, Take You Back on Rocky One, and on Rocky Two, I did Two Kinds of Love and Singing by the Trash Can. So I'd moved out here at that point.
That's right. I remember that.
I said, Sly, he kind of liked my music. So I got together with Bill Conti, and we wrote Pushin'. And I didn't like the production number of it. So I do it live. It's more like balls to the wall. I never did it live until I played Atlantic City at the Hard Rock last year. So in 40 years almost, I never played that song live, and then we did an arrangement of it.
It's a great song, the Shadowbox,
it
too.
Is.
It's got that rhythm with the piano.
No, it's a great song.
It's a great
I love
song.
The whole the soundtracks. The soundtracks in all...
It's a character.
Bill Conti didn't win the Oscar for Gonna Fly Now? Come on.
Who won that year?
You're not going to believe. I think it was The Omen. There's no songs
in
The Omen.
Oh, come on!
That scared a hell of a lot of people.
Are you kidding me?
Eye of the Tiger?
It was scary, but was not as like iconic.
Eye of the Tiger didn't win for best song? That's probably the most played song. I think
who
it has
won that year? Do you know?
I think it was Officer and a Gentleman, Up Where We Belong.
Oh, come on, Joe Cocker.
By the way, Frank, I think Eye of the Tiger was turned down by Karate Kid. I've read that somewhere.
Karate Kid was later. They did Moment of Truth. What happened is Sly was the one who goes, and he came up with the phrase Eye of the Tiger. So Scotty Brothers Record had a group called Survivor, and they wanted to really see if they could push him to the next level. So they wrote Eye of the Tiger. Everyone thinks I wrote it. I said, if I did, I'd be a kajillionaire.
Right. Survivor had a few songs.
Quite a few.
A few on soundtracks, too.
A lot of hits. They had about nine. Yeah, they had a lot of hits.
Right, but in the franchise, too.
Burning Heart.
Burning Heart was a great song.
What a great song.
That's a great song. I think that's one of the best songs in the movie.
The montages were incredible, too. You know, I mentioned Ken Norton real quick before, because we're keeping in the boxing thing for a second, who almost did it. Somebody who did appear, if you keep your eye on, and I forgot which Rocky it was. Was it two?
Duran.
Roberto Duran.
Yeah.
Roberto, was that true?
At the Main Street Gym.
Two, right?
Yeah, and he's
Rocky
sparring.
Two.
He kind of makes
no headgear sparring.
I got to tell you a funny story.
Yeah, I want to hear it.
Now, to
I'm
me,
sure.
I've seen Roberto fight. I saw him dismantle Cuevas. I mean, throw a beating on. And Cuevas was no bum. He was not a technically, but he was strong. And he was a big bang.
Made 14 title defenses, as a welterweight champion.
I was at the sports arena and just gave him a beating like he did Iran Barkley. I mean, just a beating, right? So... Sly's there. He's like 190 something, and Duran's probably out of shape, 145.
Right.
He goes, this guy was just messing. He can't hit him.
Yeah.
He's so elusive, and he's just going eek and banging Sly low on the arm. Sly goes, I couldn't lift my arms.
Wow.
This guy had power. Vinny Paz told me a great story. Vinny Paz to me is one of the tough. He's like Carmen Basilio.
Yeah.
Just tough, you know. And he goes, I remember I fought Duran, and he said, you old bastard, I'm going to knock the shit out of you. Vinny was great. And Kevin Rooney said, now, Vinny, be cool. Now you can punch. He goes, fuck. We can't punch. All of a sudden, Vinny says, the next thing I know, my face is on the canvas.
Yeah.
Duran hit him with a short right hand. My face was hit, and he got up. He goes, that old motherfucking punch.
That was a controversial decision. A lot of people thought Duran deserved that victory.
On the first fight?
Yeah.
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 And they became like best friends.
That's funny. The fact that he fought five decades is incredible.
I was actually at his fight.
1969.
Can you believe that?
I was at his fight with William Joppy. Yeah, it was one of the saddest things.
Well, that was near
That was in 1998.
And you know what? He's still kind of sharp. When you talk to him, it's unbelievable.
You know, you can't go by the Thomas Hearns fight because when he walked in the ring, he didn't look good.
No.
But listen, he's a lightweight. He almost held Hagler to a draw. It's pretty good.
Absolutely. That was a 15-round fight. Had it been 12, they say He was up on the cards right there. That was in the fact that he was a light when he captured the middleweight championship.
How about Iran Barkley?
Exactly.
Who's a big, raw-boned 168. Big guy. That's 6'2".
The 89 fight of the year, I believe.
Out-machoed him right there.
And that's almost a decade after he beat a great version of Ray Leonard. So again, these are 15-round fighters.
You know, I talk about this. As you know, I'm a historian. I have a museum and stuff like that. I wanted to show you guys something to show you the difference. These are 1910 boxing gloves. Feel how light they are.
1910. Oh my God!
And those gloves are made by Saul Levinson, and everyone wore them, whether you were a heavyweight or a flyweight.
Horsehair.
Those gloves.
These are batting gloves.
These are puncher's gloves. I'm going to tell you that right now.
I'll tell you a funny story. Wow. I met my friend Joe Burrell, who fought Harry Greb and everything like that.
That was awesome.
He said, well, you know, in days you could load your gloves. It wasn't plaster Paris. What they do, they wrap their hands, they get black electrical tape, and you could wrap your hands as much. And then they go to the edge of the table like this on the tape. So it's like this.
Oh, man.
And then, these things are 4 ounces.
And you could thumb.
Look at the thumb. It's like you can play second base.
I mean, but you could.
It looks like Ty Cobb's catcher.
It does.
And mouth guards were illegal. So it just shows you. Now I want to show you.
Oh, my gosh.
These were training gloves. Draper Maynard. So today these wouldn't even qualify as fight gloves. Look at the thumb on that. These are training gloves. These are like, this is what.
This is wild.
There were no 16-ounce gloves.
These look like the first gloves ever made.
Exactly.
Could you imagine Mayweather's complaining about Everlast gloves from Madonna?
Look at what these
guys were wearing back then. And no mouth guards. The first time that was discovered was when Jack Britton, who was one of the great 330 pro fights.
Yeah.
And he fought Ted Kidd Lewis like 16 times. So all of a sudden he's going, hey, wait a second. And they stopped the fight. They go, what's that? He goes, what are you talking about, mate? He goes, he's wearing a mouth guard, and they made him take it out because he weren't allowed to wear a mouth guard. So imagine getting hit if you had, like, crooked teeth.
I can't.
With those, it's all knuckles.
That is unbelievable. Frank, I want to get back to the documentary in a second, but before that, and just one or two more things about Rocky real quick. Mm-hmm. So, well, it actually comes from the documentary. So geographically, when Sly wrote Rocky, how much time did he actually spend in Philly? Why did he set it in Philly? Is that because he did spend a significant amount of time there?
Not as much time as I did, but yeah. No, he spent enough time in Philly to get the gist. Matter of fact, where the art museum is.
Yeah.
If you see where he's standing like this, you see right in front.
Yeah.
That's the building we lived in.
Oh, that's the building.
That close. I mean, I used to could walk. I mean, it was like 400 yards. And that's where, and I tell you, and this is honest to God truth. You could have shot a howitzer on the steps of the, and not hit anybody. No one ever went to that museum.
It wasn't a thing.
Yeah.
It's a magnificent museum.
Yeah.
And I remember in 1970, now this is really weird. 1970, I was with some guys in my rock band. We were like 19 years old, and someone gave me mescaline or something, right? So we walked around all night until it became daylight. And where did we end up? On the top of the museum steps, and we're like hallucinating, and all of a sudden that fountain turned on. It was like the wild world of Disney. It's like 80,000 cars go, oh wow, man. Who would think 6 years later that would become one of the most iconic 2 million people a year on those steps.
So now there's the actual statue. It is there.
Yeah, but it's in the wrong place. It should be where it originally
was. That's true. It is. They put it on the side.
Yeah,
they should have put it on the side on the bottom.
It just shows you the pomposity of Philadelphia. Well, we don't consider it art. Excuse me. No one ever came to the museum until Rocky.
Exactly.
It's standing there. And are you crazy?
They put it in. It should be. I know. That made me mad when
they
I went
put
to
it
go in
the
there.
Spectrum. It was hidden. So Sly goes, yeah, I think I'll take it back. Because it wasn't theirs. He loaned it to them, not for them to move it.
Yeah.
So they kind of came to a thing, and we did Rocky Balboa, where they put him at the bottom.
Right, that's where I was. I saw it at the Balboa. Yeah. Speaking of Balboa, I didn't realize when he came to L.A., he lived off of Balboa Avenue. So that's why
what a coincidence.
I know, isn't that crazy right here?
I get asked all the time my favorite Rockies. I say Rocky 1 and Rocky Balboa because they're bookends.
Yes.
I think Rocky Balboa is incredible.
I love it, too.
Talking to his son.
No, I love that
and
speech.
And I like Rocky, too.
I like it, too. Well, I'm going to ask you the ranking in a second.
You know, he ain't right for us, baby.
That's right.
I never saw you hit a man, and he kept coming.
Yeah, he's
that's his favorite line, by the way.
That's my favorite. I quote Duke all the time.
And, you know, he was a real fighter, Tony Burton. He could fight.
Yeah.
So was Burt Younger.
He looked at it. Yeah, he doesn't know that it's a he doesn't know that it's a damn, he thinks it's a damn fight.
Remember, like, he's slobbery, stick and move.
I still say Rocky II did the best transition of any sequel with the Bill Conti song called Redemption, with the two ambulances going through the streets of Philadelphia. That whole musical score is like the way it just bridges the two movies together is incredible.
How he didn't win the Oscar for best soundtrack, I'll never understand.
I don't understand.
That song is played almost at every sporting event. Eye of the Tiger is played almost at every sporting event sometime, but it just goes to show you, man.
What do they know exactly?
Hey, I got screwed out of my Oscar nomination. I don't know if I won. I was up against some, well, not really. It was when I did Far From Over. It was the Grammy Awards, the same five songs. It was Maniac, What a Feeling, Far From Over, song from Tender Mercies, no one knows, and the song from Yentl, who no one knows.
No one knows. So the other three were great, solid songs.
Solid songs. So there was same five
hits,
songs.
Hits, too, because not all hits are always songs that have come out in films and been successful. You guys had hits.
Those were hits. And then the Golden Globes were the same five songs.
Really?
So I'll never forget this. I'm sitting there doing my first solo album cover shoot. And that was the day they were announcing the Oscars. And Sly goes, well, of course you're going to get nominated. It's the same five songs, okay? So I get a phone call, and they go, it's your brother. And I'm there, I got bad news. I said, well, who died? He goes, your career. He goes, he goes, you didn't get nominated. I go, what? Me?
The other songs? Did Maniac?
Every other song got nominated except mine. You know what they did?
What?
They took another song that never even charted from Yentl.
Get out of here from Yentl. Get out of here. Now I'm pissed.
Yeah.
So, that's a great song. I'm not just saying that.
Thank you.
I was just telling my buddy, I love that song. Anytime I saw it, you can always tell with music and with certain movies, if it still rings true and gives you that same feeling you heard them years ago, then that's
Frank,
quality.
I thought Maniac was one because Michael Cimbello is a friend of mine.
Flash
so I No, but the fun thing would have been great to just been nominated for an Oscar. Two brothers nominated for Oscar.
Hell yeah.
Sly's been nominated three times.
They screwed you on that one.
Frank, is there a Rocky that you don't like? Like, Rocky V's always one that those who love the franchise kind of say, like,
Well, before he answers that, why don't you give us your ranking of Rockies in the order?
Rocky I, I love.
Okay. Masterpiece.
Rocky II, I love. I think that's the best fight scene, Rocky II. That's what even Sly admits that.
Can we pause for a second? Alvilton didn't want to direct it because he didn't like the script. Is that true?
I don't actually know what that was.
That's what Sly said in the doc.
Yeah, so Sly took over. And then Rocky III was huge. It was kind of amazing because all of a sudden he wasn't punchy and he was great looking. He had no scars.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
I said, well,
exactly. What? He got better shape.
Yeah,
he got older, he got better shape.
Well, he got civilized.
That's right.
Did they punch you into clarity? I mean, all of a sudden his hair's perfect, like no scars.
He's looking like Al Pacino in the car.
Exactly. And again, I liked Rocky III. I was in it. You know, I was in
Rocky 1, 2, 3.
Rocky IV is a great movie. Not my favorite, but a lot of people, it's their favorite.
Because
I will break you.
Incredible soundtrack.
Great soundtrack.
Propaganda, I love it.
Yeah, and then Rocky...
He saw the Cold War.
Exactly.
He did. He saw the Cold War.
And Rocky V, I said, why aren't you directing it? I think he got lazy at that point. And he let John do it. And John, I think... I love John, don't get me wrong. I think John... If what John Avildsen had not directed Rocky I don't think it would have been the same movie. Because he lived that movie, loved it. He was a great director. And Sly, I think, got lazy. And I think John had a little bit of animosity at this point because you've had four monster hits. Mm-hmm. Now John comes back. And John was a little bit of an authoritarian type guy, you know. And Sly goes, oh, he tries. No, I got it. No, so... It didn't come out as good as it was. I mean, Tommy Morrison, I'm the one that found Tommy Morrison. I said, look at this white guy, man, on
ESPN every month.
Knocking dudes out with he could punch.
Yeah.
He was on ESPN every month because he was managed by Bill Caton, who had Mike Tyson. So he was like a thing. The thing with Rocky V, it got off to a bad start to me, is the whole notion that somehow Rocky loses his money because Paulie, of all people, was in charge of the finances. I'm like, okay, so that right?
That's a tough buy.
See, that's a tougher buy than the fight scenes. I'm like,
is that when he had the great speech with his son, though?
No, that's Rocky Balboa.
That's Rocky Balboa. That's Rocky Balboa.
I can't watch Rocky Five because of Sage, my nephew. I mean, that's hard to watch.
You know, Rock, you guys, in the Sly documentary, they actually talked about probably my favorite scene out of all of them is when Mickey has to go hat in hand and ask Rocky, I want to manage you and train you for. What they left out was, I love after they hugged, and I've always wanted to ask your brother
this. I was
there. The handshake, was that script? Because it's so perfect after they kind of embraced and Rocky just said, hey, let's start anew. That handshake is so perfect the way it's shot and what happened.
That era when I was growing up, guys didn't hug each other. It was always like guys going off to war. Well, son, I'll see you when you get back. So people weren't, hey, bro, like
huggy feeling.
No. Yeah. Everything was like, all right, kid. Just that type of thing. So that's where that was from, because Mickey was an old time 1920s type fighter.
Yeah.
If I'm going to rank them really quick, I'm going Rocky 1.
Okay.
Personal favorite. Absolutely. Rocky 1, Rocky 3, Rocky 4, Rocky 2.
Oh, jeez.
Then Rocky Balboa, then Rocky.
Okay. How about you, Steve?
I've always said this, and
Creed
me and Mario.
Three. No, I'm not kidding. No.
Okay, we'll get into that. We'll get
That's
into that.
That's his personal favorite.
Okay. I think Rocky 2 is my personal favorite.
Oh, get out of here, Rocky. Get out of my face. You're completely disqualified.
I know, and I'll tell you why.
The commercial alone with that fake nose. Yeah.
No, because great. I think it's perfect, because I've dealt with this with fighters that I've had to cover, that had one great night.
Yeah.
It's great for 15 minutes, and when the Andy Warhol wears off, and he has to go back to real life. I love that scene where he could not acclimate himself to being a regular human being.
Yeah.
And then when he's in the basement after he got laid off, he's hitting the heavy bag, and he says, hey, honey, this is what you married. This is what I am. I don't expect you to be any different. And how he was kind of shamed into doing it, but there's such a realism to a fighter who's not a big star, who has one great night, but the money runs out, and then you're kind of thinking, now what? Mm-hmm. I thought that was captured perfectly.
Yeah. It was poignant, and I do love that. I just want to touch on this because they didn't really go into it too much on the in the documentary. You mentioned your nephew, who I happen to have known, and he was such a sweet kid.
He was a sweet kid. It was just a terrible thing.
What happened again?
He had some kind of rheumatic heart, and and he was a kid. You know, unlike his father, he didn't work out, and he got heavy, and he was a heavy chain smoker, was not an outdoor guy, and just had a heart attack.
Oh, man.
Yeah, Frank. We checked toxicology. We were thinking, is he doing drugs? No, he wasn't. I remember the day it happened. I was hanging out with the Nelson brothers, the rock group, and then I was having lunch. I was going to go out on a hot date that night. My brother called me. He said, Sage is dead. And I'm there.
Oh, jeez.
Definitely appetite was gone. And I went up to that. It was just it's something surreal. I can't, because what do you say?
Because he's so young.
Yeah, but what do you say to your brother whose son's dead?
It
was a real bleak whole thing.
Frank, what was your overall thoughts on the Creed franchise? There's been three of them.
I thought the first one, Sly, got ripped off. He should have won the Oscar. I thought he was incredible in that. And everyone in the audience, even the guys that were up against him, were kind of cheering for him. Because they probably all grew up watching his movies.
Right.
And he's been looked over so many times. And that was, I mean, he's in shock when he gets a good review. I mean, you can't believe it. He's never gotten good reviews other than Rock.
I like Copland, too, though. He was good. Yeah, Copland. I thought he was underrated.
Nighthawks.
I like that with the beard.
Cliffhanger.
The beard. Remember, Cliffhanger was great.
Victory. Played a soccer goal.
I liked Colbert Over the Top. I liked all
Over the Top. Great soundtrack on that one.
That was in a Kenny Loggins.
I always thought he should have done a sequel to Cobra.
Yeah.
Because I thought the first one was
Cobra
good.
Cobra Cabretti,
It just wasn't shot well because Cosmatos was not a great director. And, in First Blood, obviously.
Yes.
Mario and I watched every Creed together because we said we're going to talk about it.
Because he was dying to go see it.
Shut up. You're the one who forced me. First one, thumbs up. Double
I thought
thumbs
it was
up.
Great. Yeah.
Okay. The sequel, there were a couple times where me and Mario were working out in the desert. We're like, me and Mario, there's like four times, we're like, oh, geez. The third one, Mario, stay out of it. I don't want the shrap. Worst movie I've ever seen.
I never saw it.
I thought it was an embarrassment to the Rocky franchise. I think he's lucky not being in it.
Did he refuse to be in it? Did he not want to be in it?
Or? Well, the thing was, here's a guy that changed as far as boxing on film. If you look at all the great, supposedly great boxing movies, they're terrible. They're punching into the camera. No body shots. Nothing. You know, mm-hmm. just it's just like, you know, if you see Kirk Douglas in Champion, it's not right. You can't fight. I mean, just like, or De Niro in Raging Bull. All he's doing is going, whoa, whoa, whoa. There's no like slipping or moving or body shots.
Yeah.
So he would say when they're shooting it, he goes, why don't you try this? Now, he's a master at shooting boxing stuff. No one listened to him. So Rocky III, the director, I think he directed Creed III, like one movie. Every time Sly would suggest something, nah, I got it. So he said, no, Rocky III. So he goes, I'm like, I don't want to be involved in this. You know what? This is an ugly death. I created these characters, and I want nothing to do with it. And you know the feud he had with Shortoff and Winkler. That was kind of prominent.
So. All right. We got to take a break. And by the way, guys, I think you're the best around with Karate Kid that was originally going to be on one of the Rocky movies or something. I'm getting that songs mixed up, but one of the great songs of the Karate Kid soundtrack was supposed to be on Rocky. They didn't have room. So
what song is
it? I think it's You're the Best Around.
Ah.
Yeah, I gotta get back on Google. But anyway, when we come back, more with Frank Stallone, we're talking about boxing. This guy's a master historian. I'm talking about Burt Sugar level of historical data.
Oh, Burt Sugar it. And yeah. I used to get drunk and talk boxing.
I love it.
And I said, Burt, I love you. Lose the cigar. You're killing me, will you?
I got to have a cigar with Burt.
Burt was exactly, great.
Yeah.
He was
awesome. But anyway, we'll be back after these commercial messages.
Catch us streaming live right on YouTube. Right on YouTube.
Welcome to the big leagues, kid.
$1.2 million.
Oh. And I'm losing in this fucking game. What the fuck?
This is a 400k flip. If I win, by the way, you get 10 grand.
Cover my fucking straddle!
For my fans!
What? I read it twice!
Wow! All in a call!
I'm not fucking leaving!
Raise it up!
Back on the Three Knockdown Rule on the UFC Fight Pass. Ladies and gentlemen, if you'd like to get involved with the Three Knockdown Rule and sponsor our fine program, we'll still have some slots available. Please reach out to us by emailing info@boxbid.io. Once again, that's info@boxbid.io. Boxbid.io is an online platform that is launching soon. It helps public figures and professionals in the world of boxing get sponsorships. We are proudly working with boxbid.io.
Frank.
Yes, sir.
Speaking of boxing.
Yeah.
I want to hear about the time you fought Geraldo Rivera.
Oh, okay.
Who fancies himself a fighter.
Mm-hmm.
And it was for the Howard Stern Show, right?
Right.
1992.
Yeah. Well, tell me about
okay,
how that.
Okay, I
went
can
down.
Tell you exactly how this happened. And I hadn't boxed.
You won, though. You know, that's about
it. I hadn't fought in a competitive, like, I fought as an amateur. I didn't fight a pro. So I had 33 fights as an amateur.
Look at that.
So I hadn't fought in like 12 years. So at that time, you know, I was carousing with the girls, smoking in those days. So I go into the Howard Stern Show to promote something. And I'm standing outside, and Andrew Dice Clay is in there with Howard on the speakerphone with Geraldo. Geraldo goes, I'll fight any celebrity. I'll fight anybody. I'm trained every day. I'll fight anybody. So I'm there. Yeah, listen, I didn't want to fight anybody. So anyway, but Andrew comes out. He goes, and him and Howard, did you ever fight? I said, yeah, I fought in the amateurs. Hey, you should fight Geraldo. I said, I don't want to fight Geraldo. I'm here to,
I don't have a problem with Geraldo.
So all of a sudden, that's all Howard needed. Now he started breaking my balls. He's calling me every day on the air. You're going to fight Geraldo? I said, I don't want to fight Geraldo. So if I would have had a good manager, I could have gotten about 250 grand Ooh. To fight him. So I got another stupid move on my part. So anyway, okay, you'll fight him. I said, all right. And my brother's like incensed. He goes, if you get beaten by a talk show host, you know what that does to the Stallone dynasty? I said, oh, Christ. Now I got this pressure on me, right?
No pressure.
No pressure. So I hadn't been in the ring Like I said, 12 years. So I go over. I said, okay, I'll do it. I hadn't done road work or anything. So now I'm training my friend Tom Patty. I don't know if you know, Tom Patty trained with
Mike Tyson.
He used
to be with Mike Tyson in Catskills. Yeah.
So he's my trainer, and Tom's a good friend of mine. We're at the Jet Center, Betty, and I'm like,
Benny the Jet.
I'm dying. I said, okay, put the cigarette. I only have like 3 weeks.
I'm dying. That's a real fighter. He took it on short notice.
And all of a sudden, I'm sitting with Tom Patty, and he just, boop, hits me with a body shot. And anyone that's been, if you get a bruised rib, it is how painful is it?
You can't even breathe. You sneeze, breathe. Nothing.
I said, okay, I got a fight coming up 3 weeks. I can't even breathe. I can hardly spar. I'm sparring like, I can't, because if you just went like that on that rib, you're done. So anyway, so I'm trying to run at UCLA track with the rib. My feet feel like lead. I'm like, I said, what am I going to do? I said, I was a pretty good puncher if I catch him. So I called Randy Gordon. I said, I'll do the fight. No headgear, 10-ounce gloves.
Oh, damn.
I figure I'll get one in.
Yeah, exactly. Those gloves down there?
Yeah, exactly. I figure I'll get one in. And Geraldo had been training for like a year with Michael Lajeunesse's father.
Oh, the Silk. Yeah. I remember him, the Silk.
Yeah. So he'd been training all the time. He was in good shape. He didn't smoke. And I was like carousing with the girls and living the rock life, you know? So I said, okay, I'll do the fight. So it becomes like something. It was the biggest show we ever had because it simulcast on TV and radio at the same time. So I'm doing the fight, and I get there, and Randy Gordon, who was the commissioner, he's a good friend of mine. Yeah. He goes, Frank, you got to wear headgear. I go, what? He said, you got to wear headgear, 16-ounce gloves. I said, and Tom Patty goes ballistic. He goes, wait a second. We said 10-ounce gloves, no headgear. Thank God I brought my own headgear. For some reason, I brought my own headgear. So the big effortless 16-ounce gloves. Now, the main thing, I'm over at Gleason's gym, like training, and my rib is killing me.
Wow.
So all of a sudden, all these gangsters come in. Hey, I get 20 grand that you kick his ass. Because the mob guys didn't like him because he did exposés on him. I said, oh, Christ. So now
John Gotti has action on this.
Now I got my brother breaking my chops. And now the underworld.
The Gambinos.
It's a three-round fight. I mean, it's not like a world title fight. And he goes, yeah, you're going to kick his ass. So I get these guys with sunglasses. You can see their face and their suit. You know, shark skin. I'm there, oh, Christ almighty. So we go down there the night of the fight. And, you know, Emo Griffin, yeah, it was really have fun. And so I go down there and I said, man, what if this guy catches me a body shot? So they're shooting me up with Novocaine, like syringes in my ribs. So I go out, and again, I wasn't in great shape. You know, I mean, so you can see the first fight I'm going out, and I'm kind of really favoring this.
Yeah.
So I'm just really being careful. So boom, I hit him a shot, and I fall at one point to go knockdown. And Michael Spinks goes, it's not a knockdown. I slipped. I was wearing stupid shoes, and I slipped. And I got, now I'm really pissed, because now I look like a total jamoke, right? So then I go after him, and I start banging him with some shots. His nose is getting all red. And, you know, and I'm trying to dig in. And people go, you didn't look that good. I said, dude, I just bruised rib. I was out of shape. I'm sitting in the corner like this. Brian Hamill and Tom Patty, you're doing good. I can't even talk. I have no air. And I don't know about you. You've boxed. When you have no, and you run out of gas, it's very scary feeling.
I can't even go in there with a bruised rib because, you sneeze, it hurts.
It's but when you get gassed in the ring, you get to.
Think about it. In a real fight, the commission would not have cleared him. Yeah. They do a checkup.
No, exactly.
They probably wouldn't have told him until he touched my rib. But some guys fight broken. You know how somebody.
So you got some good shots in.
I landed some good shots in, but I wish I could have been a contender. I could have been better. Anyway, I won the fight. They gave me this goofy championship belt. And Geraldo, they said, oh, Frank, you have anything to say? And Geraldo thought I was where you got bad mouthed him. I didn't. I said, listen, man, he's a man's man. He showed up. He's older than me. He showed up to fight. And, you know, it takes a lot of balls to get into a ring. Anybody. Yeah. And so we became really good friends. And that's he's great. Also in my documentary. And so I walk outside. There must be 1,000 people outside. There's like a 3-round goofy fight. I'm holding the belt over my head. You think it's like a title fight.
That's
like,
hey, awesome. Man.
I love that. I didn't realize it. I really busted my right hand. So the 2 days later, I had to go to England to go on tour with my band. And all of a sudden, man, You know how people do
this now? Yeah.
I did that before anybody, because if you squeezed my hand, I would probably collapse. I don't know. I must have pulled something. And it's always an after. It's like if you train too hard in the gym, 2 days later, you're like.
He created the dap.
So people come up, hey, how you doing? I go, hey, man. And that was like years
That's
ago.
That's hilarious.
But it was great. Fun. And, you know, I've been a boxing collector probably for 50 years. And I have my list of who I think are the greatest fighters.
How did the love for the sport begin?
Huh?
How did the love for the sport begin?
You know, I think for me, I always liked it. You know, we grew up the era of Marciano, Basilio. I saw Ali for the first time on TV. I go, of course, our parents hated him. I said, this guy's so cool. Tassels on his shoes. In those days, he could punch. He was knocking guys out, you know? Mm-hmm. And then it was just something because, you know, we grew up, like I said, like if you read the documentary, grew up in a weird thing. So the thing about, I wish I was started like at 15, 13, because then I would knock the shit out of some of these guys that used to pick on me. You know, if you're like 13 those days, most guys can't fight. They're like, you're going to pop one jab and be over. Exactly. So I fell in love with it. And then when I started in the amateurs, I was living in Trenton, New Jersey at the time with my band. And I was basically the only white guy in the gym. And they were just great to me. Because at first, they kicked the shit out of me for a few times. The first time I started sparring, I took some poundings. And I think they were doing it to see, see if he comes back. And of course, my ego could not stand the fact that, and I kept coming back. And they were great with me. It was really, I mean, it was, and I found the camaraderie in boxing. And you know, you used to be around the gym. Yeah. It's fun.
It is
because they're always talking trash.
So many characters.
It's the greatest place on earth.
Yeah. And they're always, and these are like the toughest guys in the world. But most of them are really nice people. The behavior lately in the last 5-10 years, I don't like. I don't like the braggadocio and stuff like that.
No, I agree with you. But for the most part, Frank, wouldn't you say, I always say the world would be a better place if it was more like a boxing gym. Because, let's take Wildcard, for example, which I still go to, by the way. You'll have Mexicans, Italians, every form of Asian, Russian,
every religion,
Armenian, everyone goes in there, egos left at the door, everyone is, there's camaraderie, you have a lot of fun, it's there's respect, because no one's going to be talking shit in there, because you could just settle it.
How much fun was it
right
watching
there?
James Toney when he used to come in?
Oh, man.
Man.
That was the best.
To me, and I have a list of
born
people,
fighters.
I have a list of people that could have fought in any era. Like, I seem to favor the old-time fighters because remember, in those days, there was no video, there was no TV, there was no radio. So you didn't know who you were fighting. Mm-hmm. So you go. That's why a lot of those guys were great, like Robinson, these guys, because they could change it up. All of a sudden, I remember when I fought an amateur, a guy goes, guy can't punch. I go, how do you know? I don't even know this guy. This guy's from Connecticut. I'm in the amateurs. Coming to first round, he hits me like 3 bolo punches. I go, oh. So I go, he can punch. So you had to change it up. So in those days, you'd be fighting a guy in some tank town in the 20s, and you know everything's rigged against you, and all of a sudden the guy's like a murderous puncher. What do? You had to change up. So they didn't have stuff like they have now.
I mean, think about this, guys. When they talk about mythical matchups, I always say, okay, which rules? 15-round fights with the weigh-ins the night before or the day of? That makes a difference.
Huge difference.
And also, to me, when you have fighters who have fought over 100 times, you get a true sense of what they are. These careers now, Frank, and me and you have talked about it. Some of these guys, like Shakur Stevenson, as good as he is, his career may be 35 fights.
Now, how about this? The most fights of any fighter in history recorded. You know how many fights he had?
How many?
472 professional fights. Len Wickware from England.
Wow.
And he died of old age. He wasn't punchy at all.
Really?
Yeah.
He lived a full life.
Imagine fighting 400. He fought over 8,000 rounds.
Oh, my God.
Britain. And then Fritzy Zivic, who I love.
The Croat Comet.
Yeah.
The greatest guy. And, you know, I have an interview with Fritzy. And Fritzy, now remember, he stopped Henry Armstrong twice. And he had over 300 fights. Fritzy. He beat Jake Amada. He was a small welterweight. He beat Jake Amada. I fought everybody. So he goes like this. He talked like this, see? Like those old movies. How he used to talk.
James Cagney.
Yeah, sure. He goes, listen, I never lost a fight on Found My Life. Sure, I choke him, give him the head, hit him in the nuts. But I never thumbed nobody. Hey, listen, you're fighting. You ain't playing the piano. So those guys were rough guys. Look how they came up.
No, exactly.
And people ask me, who's the greatest Mexican fighter? Easy for me. Manuel Ortiz.
Yeah.
Really?
Oh, wow. Yeah. First of all, he was movie star handsome. He was featherweight, bantamweight champion. Could bang, tall, good-looking, like 40s, 50s, from like El Centro. He was an idol to the Mexican people. Other than then, after that was Enrique Bolaños, who was good-looking. And then there's another guy, very rare, fought, started in 1899, fought about 1908, named Aurelio Herrera. They said he hit, he was lightweight, hit as hard as like a heavyweight. And he was the most feared, good looking, but he said drank a lot, smoked cigars, but he would hit guys that, out.
Frank, what is your thoughts on today's boxing in general?
I think, one, they don't fight enough. I remember Harry Greb, they go, how good was he? I said, well, when you show me a fighter that has 45 fights in 1 year, undefeated, when there's only 8 divisions, come talk to me.
That is unbelievable. Well, I think about in my original hometown, Archie Moore, when I actually got to have some conversations with him, who I believe has the most
knockouts.
I believe he's got, he has more knockouts than anyone.
149 or something?
Yeah, something like that, like more knockouts. Amount. And he was still, I remember having a conversation,
clear.
Had all his faculties cleared, but he was in the hundreds as well.
You know, it's interesting.
He was an incredible.
He had like 230 pro fights. And then after that, the second amount was a guy who was never a champion. It was Young Stribling, who had 120. Then after that, believe it or not, is Sandy Sadler.
Yeah. Yeah.
Now, how about, now to me, the great fight would have been, who was my dear friend, was Alexis Arguello. To me, one of the greatest ever.
One of the greatest ever. Pride of Nicaragua.
Alexis Arguello's featherweight, Sandy Sadler. I think Alexis had like 70 knockouts. He could bang.
The thin man.
What do you call him? Explosive.
Explosive thin man.
Yeah.
And he was so great. And he'd go like this. He'd go, Frank. He was the nicest guy. And he'd go, no, my condition. He was always saw, when I'd see him at the Main Street gym downtown, he was always looking at his feet. I go, what are you doing? He goes, Frank, placement of your feet. I know where I am.
Frank,
and you look at him. He wasn't beat up. He was handsome.
He was handsome.
Were you suspicious of the first prior fight at the Orange Bowl?
Oh, God. Give me my mixture? Aren't you supposed to only drink
supposed
water?
Supposed to just water.
Give me the white bottle, the one I mix. And there's been theories about what was in there.
Probably
and,
blow.
I've heard from a very good source.
Can you drink blow?
It was a combination of cocaine.
He's like, yeah.
And meth.
Like,
no, what I was told by someone in the boxing game, what was in that white bottle was orange juice, honey, and cocaine. And
then
the prior camp actually just ran out on the drug test. Because back then it was not nearly as stringent as it is now.
Well, I will tell you, Alexis had, 80-some fights? To me, one of the great, probably one of the greatest featherweights. One of them.
Absolutely.
And he goes like this, Frank, I didn't understand. Ike Bunch, I hit him with the hardest punch, right hand ever. And he goes, and he just wobbled. He went like this. He goes, what? Usually that punch, it was like a Billy Costello punch. One shot, you're out.
Yeah.
Like Ray Mancini was winning the fight. What happened? Boom, boom.
That was it.
Out. It was just suspicious the way Pryor looked like he was fading in the 13th.
Yeah.
And the next round, he came out so fast and quick.
It ended in the 12th, he was ahead, wasn't he?
Yes, he was.
Panama Lewis should have been locked up in jail. Not for that, for the other fight, too.
Collins Resto.
I mean, that's horrible. That kid ended up killing himself.
Frank, what fighters today do you respect? You're like, you could fight in any era.
I think today, without a doubt, Bud Crawford. Because he's so fundamentally sound.
Ambidextrous.
He can punch ambidextrous, and he's patient.
Yep.
He's beautiful. Chavez would not want to fight him. This guy would, he's Frankie Randall on steroids.
Ooh.
And Frankie Randall could fight.
Yeah,
he could.
I remember.
He could fight. I thought Chavez was a great fighter for his time. But could he have beat Duran? I don't think so.
God, that's one fight I've always wanted to see.
The Chavez that wore down Rosario, I think as good as any lightweight.
Yeah, but Duran would knock Rosario off.
No, I'm with you, but Chapo was a guy that was on a run who could...
Chavez had underrated defense, too. He parried a lot of those punches.
He was better. Yeah, no.
That attack to the body, too.
But
that
he would
was
have trouble with, like, Benitez. Well, anyone would have trouble with Benitez.
Frank, how bad did Fury embarrass himself in the sport of boxing a couple weeks ago?
To me, at one point I was saying, this guy's kind of unbeatable. You got beat by guys had one professional marquee at Queensbury rule fight. One. I don't care if he's had a million MMA fights, but as a professional fighter. And you got dropped. I thought Tyson Fury was just going to pepper him and just bang him out.
So did I. I actually thought he might be carrying him for a while and put up, but nobody's going to get dropped, allow the Sums to get dropped. There's one thing about underestimating an opponent and not training at all, and then someone else exceeding expectations. Now, granted, he did spar or fight a little amateur, and he was a MMA champion, so it wasn't like he was a guy just off the street.
Yeah,
I mean, and he's a physical specimen. He's the guy strong. Looks like a Brahma bull. He's incredibly strong.
Yeah, he's like Sam Peter, but better.
Exactly. Yeah. But nevertheless, I too was incredibly disappointed. I thought it hurt his stock in the sense that when you're starting to talk about all-time greats, but I was telling Kim, now, for some reason, I'm really interested in the Usyk fight because I think Usyk, does Usyk have a shot? Is Tyson going to train?
Is Tyson going to train and
get a little more serious this time? But now I think the intrigue factor
is Fury
highest.
Just slipping.
How about this
That's
one?
What I'm saying. I mean, that's what I'm saying. Wait, a lot of questions are going to be answered, so now I'm excited to see it.
I think it's probably the most underdog fighter, and people don't want to fight him. Andy Ruiz. Have you seen him? He's in shape, but he can punch and he's fast.
He can't punch and he's fast. We just don't see him.
He's got to get off the $20 million. Demand. I mean,
no. Now he's at 200,000. Okay. But the thing is, when I saw him fight Chris Areola, I'm going, why, Chris? Are now you in shape?
Yeah, exactly.
When you had four title shots, you're out of shape.
I know.
Now you're in shape. Andrew Ruiz wins the title, first Mexican to win the heavyweight championship. He comes into the fight 50 pounds heavier than he won the title.
Exactly. Frank,
but he can fight.
He can fight because the guy he fought was built like a Greek god, and at the time was considered. Invincible.
What do you think of Richard Torres? Can he fight?
A little bit small. That's the problem.
How small is he? Like 6'1"?
Well, by today's standards, he's really small, and he get to the upper crust where everyone's 6'4", 6'5". He's left-handed, and he's been matched very soft by Top Rank. That's the problem.
You've got to be incredibly athletic if you're going to be that size.
Yeah,
he looks a little robotic.
He's been knocked out in the amateurs by Jalolov, who's Uzbeki, who's with Top Rank.
Yeah, he's Frank, Usyk.
Speaking of heavyweights,
you think Deontay's sitting back, lipping his chops, going, "Oh yeah."
Well, when's they going to fight again, though? Yeah. I mean, he has not fought in over a year. I don't know what is going.
I feel bad for. I feel bad for him. The one I really feel bad for, I think, is extremely talented, is Boots.
Oh, Boots Ennis. Well, that's another guy nobody wants. Nobody wants to fight him. And here's the issue.
Or Virgil Ortiz. Nobody wants to fight
him. Well, Virgil.
Well, he had some health issues.
I know,
but
I guess.
But you know what I hate, though, Frank? There used to be a time. You brought up Ray Mancini, a good friend of mine.
Yes.
And back in those days when Ray Mancini was the mandatory for an Arguello, there was, no, we're going to wait. These guys are getting to number one. And they're not, we got to wait.
No.
And I hate that.
The mindset and the mentality was different in the approach.
James Toney had to fight Michael Nunn as the mandatory in Davenport, Iowa. He wasn't, these guys wait their ways out of title shots.
Here's a great fight. Great fight. James Toney, Marvin Hagler. That's a great fight.
Because
James, first of all, had a chin. I mean, he won the heavyweight championship.
Who do you like with both when they were in their middleweight prime, James Toney or Bernard Hopkins?
Oh, James.
I like James, too.
I think
in the minority there?
When it comes to peak effectiveness and talent, even Bernard Hopkins will tell you both Roy Jones and James were more naturally gifted. I had the longer run because of my consistency.
Which is more in the discipline.
And at 160, in terms of overall skills and craft, I think James Toney, when he was focused, could fight anybody. Bruce Trampler, I said, Steve, that's one of the most natural fighters. That should have been an all-time
great. First of all, he's fearless.
Yeah, yeah.
He has no. You see him in the gym. He'd fight anybody.
Yeah.
But the thing was, the perfect dismantling of a tough guy was when he fought Iran.
Counterpunched
him. That might have been the greatest
death.
Fight of his life. And how about when he fought, the guy that was the body snatcher?
Oh,
Mike McCallum. The first fight, I've told young boxers, if you want to know the art of professional prize fighting, you have to watch the first fight, 1991.
Here's a guy
fight
no one
of the
even
year.
Knows anymore.
Yeah.
The body snatcher. Best 54 pounder ever. We have to get running.
Who's the best puncher, though, at 54?
At 54. Julian Jackson.
Over Terry Norris?
Terry could bang.
Terry
he was a speed, but boy, just.
No, just punching. You didn't talk about that.
When Julian hit him with that right.
Oh, Mike, he froze him on the ropes.
I asked guys.
He revenged that loss, didn't he?
Yeah, in a rematch. No, I don't. Yeah, did they?
He did in a rematch.
Who said he
could punch? No, you're talking just punching. He could punch.
Yeah, I don't think he ever fought Julian. It was Gerald McClellan, I think they fought twice. No. It was Simon Brown. He got revenge.
Nigel Benn.
Gerald McClellan. Rabbit punches.
Nigel Benn was a tough. Listen.
Dang, Frank loves
those
stuff. I love
tough,
it.
Man. All these guys. You look at Battling Nelson at Walgas. I have the gloves from that fight, 1910. Scheduled.
Damn.
Scheduled
1910, Frank.
45 rounds.
Those were
three-minute rounds.
Those were men,
so that
Mario.
Means that's
45
two
rounds.
Hours of boxing and an hour of a minute. So you got 45 minutes. So the whole fight is 2 hours and 45 minutes.
Yeah, and by the way, the
2 hours and 45 minutes. Say you're fighting for 2 hours and 40 minutes, and then you get a cut and it has to end.
Yeah, well, how about this?
How about trying to do punch mitts for 45 rounds?
Oh, God. The undercard is the first 10
with
rounds.
With McAfoley chasing you around.
Oh, God rest McAfoley. My favorite mitt guy of all time. Frank, final question, and we're going to bring you back. We have so much to discuss with you.
Oh, I love it. I told you, I love your show. I love talking boxing. I love talking the history of boxing because you got to know where things come from.
Exactly.
We look at Henry Armstrong, 5'3" basically almost had four titles when there were eight divisions. Yeah. He went from featherweight to welterweight and then won the lightweight title. And then he fought Seferino Garcia, who was the middleweight champ. And most people think he won the fight.
It was a draw.
It's 5'3".
Well, the closest to that, I think, has been Manny Pacquiao. As far as...
Yeah, great.
So, Frank, final question for this appearance. Yeah. Is Ray Robinson, in your view, the greatest ever?
Yeah, I have two. I have Ray Robinson and Harry Greb. As the two greatest fighters, I think Ollie's the greatest heavyweight. And I think Larry Holmes is pretty close. Larry Holmes could fight.
I'm going to go with the other Ray, respectfully.
Leonard?
Only because
great fighter.
Only because I think he fought more athletic black dudes than Ray Robinson. Ray Robinson was playing.
He might have,
but Ray Robinson also fights some bad black dudes too.
He did, but not as many. I don't think I do, but he did beat a lot of white guys.
The thing, it's that famous.
Well, it's kind of like when the NBA. See the NBA when they used to play the guys back in the day, but you see them play now.
Carmen Basilio was Gene Fulmer were no slouches.
Right? No, there were no slouches.
Mario, but it does remind me though. Ray Leonard once went up to the great Teddy Brenner, matchmaker at Madison Square Garden, and he goes, "Hey, Teddy," he goes, "how would you compare me to Ray Robinson?" And Teddy just looks and goes, "Ray, fight 200 more times and I'll tell you." So again, that's the activity, thing about Ray. He only had 39 pro fights, though.
Who got mad at Floyd Mayweather when he was comparing himself to Ray Robinson? I think Mike Tyson.
Mike Tyson.
He goes, "Wait a minute, you had 50 fights. He had 102 knockouts."
Yeah.
And most of Ray Robinson's middleweight fights, he was actually giving up 4 or 5 pounds.
Oh, he was never a
junior middleweight fighting guys at 106 pounds.
Really a welterweight.
What shows the greatness of Ray Robinson, I mean, one thing I loved about him, he was always a gentleman. He never badmouthed another fighter.
Classy guy.
When he fought Joey Maxim, Joey Maxim was 6'2", fought Ezra Charles, fought Archie Moore, fought Harold, one of the light heavyweight champion of the world, had a chin, McAfoley's favorite fight, chin of steel, not exciting, but and Ray Robinson was beating him for like 12 rounds in 102 degree weather. Mm. The reason he lost the fight, he collapsed because he was 100 and maybe 50.
And the referee
fainted.
He made it longer than the referee in that fight actually had to be replaced.
I did not know the referee.
They had to bring in another ref.
Damn, that's brutal.
So Robinson was only the second knockout victim with the heat. But that's how impressive the heat was.
Remember, Ray Robinson was never stopped, never knocked out. Never.
Unbelievable. So the irony, I never went down, Ray. It's actually Ray who never went down.
And look who. How about tough guy? How about. Jake LaMotta.
Oh, man.
Five times. Fought Gene Fulmer a few times. Yeah. Carmen Basilio. But anyway.
Fritzy Zivic.
Fritzy got Zivic. To meet Jake LaMotta, have a cool picture with him. I don't know if I ever
showed
you that.
He's a salty guy.
When you were up there at Canastota.
Yeah, when I was Canastota.
Mario got a little mad at me because I can interview Sly. I go, "I don't know, Mario. He doesn't, Sly's the guy that would be interviewed." I said, "But Mario's my friend." He goes, "Yeah, I like Mario, but you." He goes, "Everyone's going to be breaking my balls."
All right. Well, Frank, look, we got to bring you in. Now, by the way, how many times a week do you go to Justin Fortune's gym, our good friend?
I haven't gone in a while because I'm really suffering from, I'm going to have my shoulder operated on, and I have my L2, and I sound like an old accountant. Hey, my back's doing. So everything it's like an old car. You replace the parts. I'm trying, Mario. But the thing is, I go to Justin. I love Justin. Justin's a tough guy.
Oh yeah.
Yes. I would not fought Lennox Lewis.
That's 5'8". So when you go I said all fighters they're all tough. Like here's a quick Michael Carball. Wait, what?
108.
Okay. Planet Hollywood. Now, when he used to drink, he got very mean, Michael Carvajal. There's a big guy, and maybe he weighed 115. He hit the guy. By the time the cops came, the guy was still out. That just shows you when people go, "Hey, man, he doesn't look that big." I said, "He'll kill you."
That's what they call them, the little hands of stone.
Eric Morales looks like nothing. He'd kill you.
Oh, no, he's a mean dude, too. Yeah.
So anyway, Frank, we really appreciate you coming in. Man. You have an open door. We want you to come in many times.
Not flew by, Frank. We got to come hang.
No, I love talking the game, and I really love the game. And I And I just, you know, the thing, I'm a little over with the stare down. I'm over with the thing. Like Marvin Hagler wouldn't let anyone in the dressing room. He, I'm here to fight. I'm not here to talk.
I love it.
No, there was a
we got to do a fight night with you, Frank.
Absolutely. Oh, I watched the Ryan Garcia tank. What an eclectic crowd that was. Lorenzo, Lorenzo, if you're out there, thank you. Your hospitality
hey,
that
next
night.
Next one coming up. Priebus Haney. We should do that one.
We'll do that
okay,
one.
Okay, that sounds
I'm going
good.
For I think Priebus.
Regis Program,
I like
Program,
how
yes.
he talks. So do I. But he's a tough guy.
I got right, he could crack.
All right, we'll do that
Let's
one
do
then.
That one.
All right, so anyway, on behalf
we'll do a lot simulcast.
Oh my God, you know, we'll blow it up. We'll make that pay per view.
Was that house great?
Yeah, it was unbelievable. That was more than a house. But anyway, on behalf of Frank Stallone, Mario Lopez, Smoking Tim Frazier, and Tito on the edits till the next three knockdown rule. Goodbye, everybody.
All right. That was great.